eternity. There's a question that is supposed to be dawning, and I think most of us have been asking that question. Whatever thing that you've ever been doing, at least in one way or the other, you've ever been longing one day to inherit the kingdom of God. What is the greatest hope of Seventh-day Adventists? Where are you here? The greatest hope, yes? Yes? The blessed appearing of what? Our Lord Jesus Christ. That is what we are looking for. And when he appears and comes and takes us home, looking for that glorious appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, we are longing, we are tired of this world, living in perilous time. When Christ comes, we are longing to go home with him. So the question is, where will you be able to spend eternity? At risk of what? Of eternal loss. That is the subtopic of the main one, of the main topic. At risk of what? Eternal loss. It means that if you will be able to spend eternity somewhere, either where, we have two places where you can either find yourself, you cannot be both. Where or where? In heaven? In heaven or in heaven? So it means we are at risk of what? We are at risk of eternal loss. We are going to discuss about 9 characteristics between the Father and the Son. And that one has ever been a point of controversy in our church. Tomorrow evening, let's pray that we reach there. We shall be able to discuss something. And I pray that we shall be able to reach there tomorrow evening, so that you can be able to see something. But one of the subjects that actually has been bringing a lot of controversy is the God what? The God. Today I want to, we shall only be able to tackle about the characteristics, 9 characteristics about between the Father and the Son. I always have a problem with this thing. I find it nice when I speak without this. I don't know whether it will be able to overwhelm with you. But let me try today, because it always affects my voice. So tomorrow I will be able to have a problem. Now, 9 characteristics between the Father and the what? And the Son. At risk, know that where shall you be able to spend eternity? And the subtopic is at risk of what? Eternal loss. Now, 9 characteristics of the relationship between the Father and the Son. Before anything was created in this planet Earth or in this universe, 9 characteristics that they share. The first one is the Father and the Son are what? 2 distinct. The Father and the Son are 2 distinct individuals. They are 2 separate what? Persons. There's some people that have not been saying that. How can the Father? You see, some people have been saying that Christ is not who? He's not God. We have, I don't know which one is right to say. We have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And some people say it's God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Which one is right? Help me preach. Which one is right? Yes. God the Son, God, the Holy Spirit. Another person with a different opinion. You say the one that is correct is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Next, another person. What do you think? You also say that. That we have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy. What is wrong when you say God the Son, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? What is wrong with that? And so as you're going to continue, the first characteristic is that the Father and the Son are two distinct persons. Let us get John chapter 17, verse 5 says, "And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thy own self, with the glory which I had with what?" It means we have the Father and we have what? The Son. So this Christ talking to his what? His Father. Next. John 17, 22 says, "And the glory which thou gavest me," that who gave him? God gave who? The Son. "The glory I have given them, that they may be one, even as we." That one is what? Plural. We. More than what? One. So they are, the Father and the Son are two what? Separate beings. Or two separate persons. That is why you say we have what is known as three persons in what? In one. We are told that when a man shall leave his father and his woman, shall be able to cleave with what? With the wife, and then they shall be two. They shall be two. Shall be two in what? In one. So it means if two can be one, then what is wrong with three being one? So it means if two is one, then three can be one. Can be one. So three persons in what? In one. The unity that exists between Christ and his disciple, that is ministry of healing, says the unity that exists between Christ and his disciple does not destroy the personality of either. Mm-hmm. They are one in what? Purpose, one in mind, and one in what? Character. But what? Not in what? In person. So it means the Father and the Son are one. What makes them become one? One? Purpose, mind, and character. And then one in person. They are not one in what? In person. So it means that the Father and the Son are two separate persons. But they are one in what? Character, mind, and what? Next, the Father, the second one is, the Father and the Son are intimately related to one another. Hence, they are described as one. When you say the word intimately, what is the meaning? Yes. Very close. Intimately related, as in they are close, very close to each other. The Son and the Father are intimately related to one another. John chapter 10, verse 30 says, "I and my what? Father are what? One." So what is the meaning of that verse then? Let me preach. What is now the meaning of that? We have said the Father and the Son are two separate what? Persons or two separate beings. But they are one in what? In purpose, in mind, but they are not two persons to separate themselves. So when Christ says, I and my work, Father, are one, that means they are one in purpose, one in mind, and my work, can't. So he's saying, so you have two distinct persons that are one in character and in the sense of unity. Continue. You can read the upper part. But he's saying, from eternity, there was a complete unity between the Father and the Son. They were two, yet little short of being I work. Look at that. They are not many. Two, but they are. They are two, yet little short of being what? Identical. And it means when the Father and the Son stands here, can you be able to differentiate them? So it means though they are two, but to differentiate them, that was a problem. They are almost identical. That is youth in structure. Instructor saying two in individuality, yet one in spirit and a heart and what? And character. Next, characteristic number three. So the first one you have said, the Father and the Son are two separate what? Persons. The second one, the Father and the Son. Yeah? Are intimately what? Related. And the third one is both the Son and the Father are equally what? God. They are 100% one. God. Remember, our topic is where will you spend what? Eternity. And the subtopic is at risk of what? Eternal laws. Somebody maybe is asking me, like, how are these two things related? We shall come to that. Now continue. So we have said the third one is the Father and the Son are what? 100% what? God. Same. One and there. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So it means, can you? It means that Jesus Christ is not 99% what? God. He is what? 100% God. Like how the Father is what? Is God. So Christ and the Son are 100% God. The scripture clearly indicates the relationship between God and Christ. They bring to view us clearly the personality and the individuality of each other. God is the Father of Christ. Christ is the Son of what? Look at that. God is the Father of what? The Father of Christ. And Christ is the Son of God. To Christ has been given an exalted position. He has been made equal with the what? With the Father. Who is the Father? He is God. So if Christ has been made equal with God, with the Father, it means that he is 100% God as the what? As the Father. At risk of eternal what? Loss. Continue. The Savior was the brightness of his Father's glory and the expressed image of his person. He possessed the divine majesty, perfection, and excellence. He was equal with God. It pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. So, God, Jesus Christ, and God the Father are what? Equal. And that means that they are both what? God, 100% God. Continue. Christ was the Son of God. He had been one with him before the angels were called in existence. Let's continue. The fourth characteristic is there is a special what? intimacy, that is, at least you have looked at the glimpse of that word, intimacy, between the Father and the Son. And this intimacy is expressed by stating that the Son is in the bosom of God, of His Father. What is the meaning of the word bosom? Yes. Bosom. The bosom.
When God thinks something,
Hallelujah. When God thinks or when God thinks about something, then the person that actually puts what God thinks into action is Christ. As in, Christ put the mind of God into action. When God is thinking something, what will be able to do or to bring that one, that which God takes into action is what is who? Is Jesus Christ. So is the expressed image of God. By the way, the Pharisees, they were the teachers of the world, of the law, who were seated where? In Moses' seat and teaching people about the law. But when the law came, they never recognized it. They rejected the law himself. So who was Christ? Christ, the law is the transcript of who? Of Jesus. And Jesus is the embodiment of the law. Hallelujah. Are you getting me? The law is the transcript of who? Of Jesus. And Jesus Christ is the embodiment. As in, Christ is the law in a living what? A living form.
So Christ is the expressed image of the Father.
Number six. Let's begin from number one. The first character. Two distinct persons. The second one, intimately related to the third one. They are 100% what? God. The fourth one. They have special intimacy. That one is? The Son is at the bosom of what? Of His Father. Intimately related. The fifth one? Expressed image of the Father.
Number six says Jesus is the Father's second what?
Self. The Father's second self.
Look at this verse here. I think you remember when Philip asked Christ, that Jesus said that to him, "Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me?" And then Christ says this, "He that hath what? Hath seen me, hath that what?
Has seen the Father." It means Christ is the second self of whom? So whenever you look at Christ, you are also, can also be able to see God in what? In Christ.
Continue. Youth instructor says, from eternity there was complete unity between the Father and the Son. They were two, yet we have read this identical, two in individuality, yet one in spirit and heart and character.
Jesus is the second self of God.
Next. It is 7:40. The Father and the Son are composed of the same substance.
What is that? The Father and the Son are composed of the same what? Substance. What is this substance? Was the Father created? Was Christ created? What is this? By the way, what are we composed of? Soil, is it? But what is the Father and the Son composed of? Let me ask you. When God was creating, He created a perfect man and placed him in a perfect environment, that is the garden of God, of Eden. And when He placed them there, He placed them
they never had more. Yes, they didn't have more. So when they were literally naked, yes, they were covered with the glory of God. So when the Bible says they were naked, but they didn't realize, that means that they were not having human bedrock cloth, but they were having a divine bedrock. That was the glory of what? Of God. You know that God covered man with literal robe of righteousness and spiritual robe of righteousness. That is why when man sinned, what happened is, and Romans, this is Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fallen short of God's word. So the glory that covered man departed. But now, you have been told that the Father and the Son are composed of the same word. Substance. What is the substance? Now look at this. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the word, form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. With God. So it means the same substance that composes Christ is the same substance that God the Father is what? Is composed. So who is in the form of God? With that firmness, with what firmness and the power he uttered these words, the Jews had never before heard such words from human lips, and convicting influence attended them. For it seemed that in the divinity flashed through humanity. And Jesus said, I and what? My Father and what? That is the only point that I love the Pharisees. They are the people who would not be able to just kneel down and begin worshiping what? A human being. They knew that if a human being cannot be able to walk, to forgive sins, but little did they know that Christ was who? Was God. So that is why he came to his own, but his own did what? Rejected, did not know him. So the Pharisees, though they were teaching about the law, but they never recognized who the law was. That is why Christ told the disciples that, go and preach and tell them that the kingdom is what? At hand. Who was that kingdom? The kingdom of what? Of grace. But they never realized. So they were angry. They were angry. And then they say, and that the words of Christ were full of deep meaning as he put forth the claim that he and the Father were of one substance, possessing the same word, attribute. What are the substances that actually composes Christ and God and the Father? They have the same word, attributes. Continue. Christ was God, essentially, and in the highest sense, he was with God from eternity. God over all, blessed forevermore. So Christ was God, essentially, in the highest sense. Second last is the glory of Jesus is the glory of the Father. Shining in what? In him. What is the meaning of that word? Christ is the what? The glory of the Father shining in what? In him. It means the glory that Christ is having is whose? Is whose? Is the Father's. Now look at this. Who being the brightness of his glory, who is that? and the expressed image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power. So Christ is the brightness of the Father's word. Glory. As in, the one who makes the glory of the Father becomes more bright is who? Is Jesus. Continue. And 14 says, John, and the word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten who? So when Christ came, I like the message in Sanctuary. You see, most of us, by the way, brethren, we need to read. Tomorrow evening, I shall be able to talk. We need to read. I know most of us, we only have the superficial message of the Sanctuary. If we could be able to read the deeper meaning of the Sanctuary, then we would get that actually God wants. God is really interested in our salvation. The secrets of the Lord are with them that have what? That faith. When Christ came, we have this message in the Sabbath that is known as righteousness by what? I don't know what you should be, people should preach that topic. Righteousness by faith, they are divided into four sentences. One, when Christ came, he came to weave the robe of righteousness. By being that he had to die the death that we ought to have died, and he lived a righteous life. So by that, Christ was weaving the robe of righteousness. That is the first topic. After weaving the robe of righteousness, we are now supposed to go and claim the robe of righteousness. After claiming the robe of righteousness, we are supposed to wear the robe of what? Are you seeing where we are going? Christ came to give the robe of righteousness. After weaving the robe of righteousness, we ourselves must have to go and pledge the robe that Christ has worn, has woven. And then after that, we have to wear, lastly, after wearing, the robe of righteousness. One must be what? Examined. So there is examination of the role of righteousness. Two. Now, four topics are very interesting. And the serious one is examination of the role of righteousness. No, I'm not saying to go there. I was just telling you here, when Christ came, he tabernacled among us. By that means that Christ lives with us by living the life that we ought to have lived, and died the death that we ought to, so that we can be able to what? To get the role that he has given us. We beheld his glory. And then, as it says, God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness and shine in our hearts, to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of what? Of Jesus. So Christ is the brightness of the glory of the Father. Is the one that is making the glory of the glory of God to shine brighter. As in, the glory of God is reflected in what? In the Son. Lastly, because my time is up, even though the Father and the Son are in a level of equality of persons, the Son, from eternity past, has been under the Father's what? Has been under the Father's what? Authority. As in, the Father is the head of who? Father is the head of the Son. You know what? As in, the Father is the one that is having the authority. But Christ is having a delegated what? Authority. Are you getting me? The Father is having the authority, but Christ is having a delegated authority from the what? From the Father.
Now look at how this one happens. Let's continue. 1 Corinthians says, but I will have you know, the head of every man is Christ, the head of every woman is the man, and the head of Christ is who? Is God. Let's continue. From the eternity past to the future to come, the Father has an absolute authority, and the Son has a delegated authority, though they are what? One. As in, there is nothing that Christ can be able to do without the Father's what? Conscience. The Father must be able to give an what? Okay. You remember when God, the Father, God, the one of the universe, world, the universe, the world was created by what? One, is it? So when God spoke, who was doing the work of creation? Is who? Jesus. God what? God gives authority. King Jesus Christ does what the Father wants. As in, Christ has never done something. By the way, he's also saying in the is it the book of John that says that he is always doing the will of his what? Of his Father. And then when Christ was about to die, he told his Father, if it be your will, Now what is that word that Christ said? May this cup of indignation pass me. There is a word there before that. He asked Christ God that God let it be your will that this cup of indignation what pass me. But he said, not my what? My will, but your will be done. Tomorrow I shall come to tell you, do you know that it reads a point that Christ himself even said that I'm not going to die anymore? And he said, God made the cup of indignation pass me. Because he had seen how terrible and how painful the sin was going to be. And he told his father, blood, three times. But he said, let your will be what? So the Son is always working under the authority of God. Then he said, the Father then made known that it was ordained by himself. You see, at this particular time, this is the time that resulted to the rejection of Lucifer from heaven. When the Father now wanted to tell the whole universe the position of the Son. When he had the Father claiming, saying, the Father then made known, maybe let me begin from our saying, the great Creator assembled the heavenly host, that he might, in the presence of all the angels, confer the special honor upon his Son. The Son was seated on the throne with the Father. And the heavenly throng of holy angels was gathered around them. What these people are sitting on the throne? The Father, the Word, and the Son. Where was Lucifer? Where was Lucifer? Where was Lucifer? He was among the world. The angelic host. Who surrounded him? Now look at this. The Father then made known that it was ordained by himself. Who? By God himself, that Christ, his Son, should be equal with him. This one made the devil of Lucifer. He was not, as in he never wanted to be under the rulership of who? Of Jesus Christ. And then, so that whatever or wherever was the presence of his Son, it was as his own presence.
Any place that Christ would be, there God the Father was also with him.
Lastly,
the word of the Son was to be obeyed as readily as the word of the what? Of the Father. His Son, he had invested with authority to command the heavenly host, especially was his Son, to work in the union with himself in the anticipated creation of the earth and every living thing that should exist upon the earth. His Son would carry out his will and his purposes, but would do nothing of himself alone. The Father's will would be fulfilled.
So Christ was not doing his will, but was doing the will of the
world. Of the Father. Just go on. Just go on. Now, even after his incarnation, Jesus was still under the authority of his Father. Matthew says, all power is given unto me in heaven and on earth and on earth. Continue. In eternity future, Christ will still be under the subject of his what? Of his Father. First Corinthians says, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under what? Under him. Even God the Father has put Christ, become the power, or has put everything under the foot of Christ. Christ himself is still under the prerogative of who? Of the Father. Now let us look closely at the creation of man. You're not going there. My time is up. I said, always the cross of my presentation is in the last 3 days of my what? My presentation. Now here, I want you to look at when God created Adam and he created Eve, was there a relationship between them that was also found in the world? In the Father and the what? The Son. And then after that, a priest of what? Answer God? But because of time. Where should we go to spend eternity? We have made it a bit of look at this part. We have realized that God and the Father, God and the Son, and we are not talking about the Holy Spirit, but God the Father and the Son are what? Are two separate beings, but both of them are one. Are one in purpose, in character, and in what? And in mind. But what happened is, when God created Adam and Eve, he created, and where was Eve created from? From the rib of what? From the bosom of what? Of Adam. And therefore, the great position that Adam had was who? If the great position of possession that the Father, what the Father had was who? Christ, look at this. Adam had Eve as the great possession. The Father had Christ as the great possession. Look at this. When Eve departed from Adam, he listened unto the voice, and as a result, she ate the what? The fruit in it. Was Adam, did Adam, by the way, realize that before Adam ate the fruit, he realized that actually this is the fruit that we were told not to eat. So what happened? He realized it. But was he able actually to let go in the greater possession? Was Adam ready to let go his possession? When man had sinned, was God the Father ready to let go his only possession, Jesus Christ? Hallelujah. Oh, my time is up. At risk of eternal lost, where shall we be able to spend eternity? This Christ came and died for you and me. The Father was not willing to leave or to let go his Son. But what happened? As a result of sin, Christ went before his Father three times, pleading that let me go and die for the sake of humanity. Three times the Father was not willing to leave or to let go of his Son. Just at the same way, Adam was not ready to let go or to lose his own possession that he was. What did Adam do? Adam said, we are going to die what? Together. But what did God do contrary to what Adam did? Adam was not ready to let loose or to let go his what? His possession. But what did God do? Though he was not ready to let go his possession, he was faced with two opinions. One, we have the heart and we have the son. And you know what? The Father said, my son, I love you. I want to have the what? The one. But you want, it is harder, I use and what God? And what? I say the one. This is it, God says. This is it. For God to love the Son. Oh, it is not written like that in the Bible. So, between the Son and the Father, whom do you think God loved most? So, for God so loved that he gave up. To give up means. So that is what God did in exile. As if God gave his Son. Go, I have a lose. But what? How do you know that when many times was going to die, we shall look back tomorrow. When he was going to die, he never knew that we'll be able to come out of the world. So it is humanity. He never knew that we'll be able to come out of the world. He knew that the wrath of God against him was so great that he would not be. God gave his Son. But did Adam give his wife? Let's say another. Where will you spend eternity? We shall look at this tomorrow when God announces. May God bless us. I wanted us to learn about. Tell me the story of God. You would have looked at this, then you would have wiped them together, and then you can be able to understand why I said, at risk of eternal loss, where I shall be able to spend eternity. Tell me the story of Jesus. Let's sing that song, stanza one, and especially the last stanza. Uh-huh. care. And let's go to chorus. The chorus says, as in you expect what? To help them make the gods of heaven what? Ring a head. But when you see the redemption what? Story, what they will, what will they do? They will also join you in their choir. They will fold their wings for they know how to sing the story of redemption. No, for falling not not the one redemption is told to be our most precious Father. You are worthy to be exalted, to be worshipped, and to be praised forever and ever. Our Lord, you are not willing to give your Son to come and die for us. But because you loved us more than him, our Lord, you gave him that we might be rescued and we might be brought back into reconciliation and to the whole Lord. But still we reject him, we despise him, and we have spurned him. Our Lord, we have now trodden upon his precepts and dictates. Oh Lord, bring us back that you might be able to know how to worship thee. Help our prayer and our worship be accepted before thee. Bless us now and forevermore, for we pray in Jesus Christ's name.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell of Jesus and his love.